My objective was to knock him out and win in spectacular fashion.
It feels good to have some terror in my life. I mean, something that really frightens me.
Mike Tyson, 218¼ pounds.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Atlantic City's Convention Hall.
The fight didn't live up to the event. Now, will the event, the richest in sports history, live up to the fight? Hello, I'm Larry Merchant. Ordinarily, I don't go around posing riddles. But the Tyson-Spinks showdown, or blowdown, invites one. Obviously, a first-round knockout is something of a letdown. Yet, when it's accomplished with such brute skill by a great fighter, there's a pretty good chance it will become one of those highlights that define a champion. That will outlive the event. We're going to show you the fight, of course, as well as the tumult and the shouting around it. And we'll replay that devastating minute and a half in slow motion with trainer Kevin Rooney analyzing Mike Tyson's brute skill. Mike Tyson committed himself to appearing with us, but as he has with so many others recently, in and out of the media, he was a no-show. We'll talk to Rooney about the soap opera controversy that led to Tyson's unconvincing retirement. We'll talk to boxing experts about the bizarre events around the event and Tyson's place in boxing history already. And manager Bill Caton will give us his side of the infighting with Don King and Mike Tyson. We'll also show you some other one-round knockouts, famous and infamous, that are part of boxing history. Now, Atlantic City. In the movie Atlantic City, an old man who doesn't understand the brave new world of legal gambling points to the ocean and says, "It used to be a great ocean." For one night at least, on June 27th, it was great again.
This is the convention center on the famous boardwalk in Atlantic City, where Trump Plaza plays host to a fight being billed as Once and For All. Undefeated world heavyweight champion Mike Tyson defends his crown against another undefeated heavyweight with a claim to the title, Michael Spinks. It's scheduled for 12 rounds.
Each event of this kind has its own momentum, the character of this night not yet defined. Those who were at Ole Frazier in 1971 say they remember the incredible wall of sound which preceded the opening bell of that fight. We don't yet know what we'll all remember from Tyson Spinks, but the excitement of the occasion at this moment is unmistakable.
And now you are looking live at the ring where moments ago in the dressing rooms a major controversy erupted. You're looking at a tape shot of Butch Lewis, the manager of Michael Spinks, who went wild after he discovered that Mike Tyson had had his hands taped and apparently had the gloves put on without a representative of Spinks' camp being in Tyson's dressing room.
It seems a little late to be yelling about that one. Why wasn't somebody in there when that happened? I don't know that they try to slip one past everybody. Nobody thinks that Mike Tyson has anything in his gloves besides his fists, but it is unusual.
Another look at Butch Lewis, apparently in a state of extreme agitation over the fact that Tyson's gloves were placed on his hands and the taping of Tyson's hands took place without a Spinks representative in the dressing room. For people who may be new to the sport of boxing, Ray, what would he fear?
Well, all he can do is use excessive amount of tape. That's the problem, because that's illegal.
And now, the Michael Spinks camp has communicated to the Tyson camp that contrary to the planned order of entrance into the ring, Spinks now will not exit his dressing room first, and he will play a waiting game to try to make Tyson come out first.
I honestly don't know why you'd want to make Mike Tyson mad, or madder than he normally is before a fight.
There are any number of political experts at ringside. Perhaps someone can be summoned to intervene. Will it be Donald Trump, the man who paid $11 million for the right to see this fight in his building? Will it be Don King, the promoter of the fight?
This is the guy that can handle everything. In fact, he was the guy that took care of the last IBF situation.
That is indeed Larry Hazard, chairman of the New Jersey State Athletic Commission.
Hazard seems to be leaving ringside to see what he could do about it.
You mean you're not having fun, Larry?
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time
I thought by this time I would have held my breath for about 8 minutes because of all the furious action in the ring.
There goes Larry Hazard as he makes his way now to the dressing rooms to try to clean things up. Tale of the tape and of age, of course, Spinks 10 years older, 3 inches taller, 6 pounds lighter, and with a 5-inch longer reach. Tyson is unlikely at any point in his career to face an opponent who has a shorter reach than he does.
The former heavyweight champion of the world.
Now Michael Buffer goes back to work making introductions in the ring.
See our punch stat, Larry. Numbers. Spinks throws many more punches, but Michael Tyson lands a very high percentage of hard punches. That will be reflected in the numbers of jabs they throw. Tyson throws an average of about a dozen jabs around. Spinks, twice that many.
The fight will be fought under New Jersey rules, 10-point must system, 3 judges scoring, no standing 8 count. A fighter here cannot be saved by the bell in any round, even in the 12th and last round. You go down, you gotta get up. 3 knockdown rule, not in effect for this championship fight, and the doctor is empowered to stop it if he sees fit to do so.
And there you
there
see
goes
Larry Hazard
as he makes his way towards Spinks' dressing room. Now this is a competent administrator who has a long relationship with Butch Lewis. And we'll see what he can get done. And in case, incidentally, we needed any more pre-fight controversy to deal with, I've just received information from the far side of the ring that Mrs. Tyson, Robin Givens Tyson, has apparently filed a lawsuit against Bill Caton and the management organization which has been managing Mike Tyson. No details yet, but it is our understanding now that a lawsuit has been filed today on behalf of Mrs. Tyson and those forces who want to separate Mike Tyson from that man. For $13.5 million guaranteed, Michael Spinks begins
about a 200-foot walk to a 20 by 20-foot ring. For Michael Spinks, he hasn't lost a fight in 12 years.
Michael Spinks is a winner. He finds a way to win. Will he find the way tonight?
Often under unusual or trying circumstances. This crowd, Larry, has flattened out. It's going to take some action to get them back to the fever pitch, which we felt about 15 minutes ago. Structure of the place is such that the crowd takes a while to become aware of the fighter exiting the dressing room and coming in. And there you see a shot from behind the young champion as he and his entourage make their way. A much smaller group than the one which brought Spinks into the arena. And of course, as always, no shirt, no robe, no accoutrement. Like Michael Spinks, Mike Tyson is unbeaten as a professional fighter. The period of inactivity, 97 days, relatively brief for a heavyweight or for any pro.
A record of 34-0. And that doesn't count his recent bouts with his wife and his manager.
And now let's go once again to ring announcer Michael Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Atlantic City's Convention Hall, courtesy of Mr. Donald Trump's Trump Plaza Hotel and Casino on the Boardwalk in Atlantic City, New Jersey. Tonight, Don King Productions presents World Championship Boxing. This belt is presented with the approval of the New Jersey State Athletic Control Board, Boxing Commissioner Larry Hazard, Chairman Jerry Gormley, Deputy Commissioners Nick DiBalestrari and Lawrence Wallace. It is sanctioned by the International Boxing Federation. At ringside, President Robert W. Lee, the ringside supervisor Bill Brennan. The World Boxing Council is represented by President Jose Suleiman and representative of that organization, Dr. Elias Ganem. The World Boxing Association, its president, Gilberto Mendoza, at ringside, along with James J. Binns, Esquire, legal counsel, and championship committee chairman, Dr. Elias M. Cordova. The three judges for this contest, John Stewart, Eva Shane, and Rocky Castellani.
Chief ringside physician, Dr. Frank B. Doggett. Also at ringside, Dr. Stanley Eden and Dr. Charles Wilson. The timekeeper, Roosevelt Gilbert. And counting for the knockdown seconds, Joe Cortez. And the referee is Frank Cappuccino. In 1960, an Olympic gold medal winner. In 1964, the heavyweight championship. 10 years later, again, the world heavyweight champion. And in 1979, he won it an unprecedented third time. Perhaps he is the greatest of all time, ladies and gentlemen, the former three-time heavyweight champion of the world, Muhammad Ali! And now, ladies and gentlemen, once and for all, let's get ready to rumble. 12 rounds for the undisputed heavyweight championship of the world. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the white trunks with black trim and weighing in at 212 1/4 pounds. He's originally from St. Louis, Missouri, now lives in Wilmington, Delaware. This Olympic gold medal champion has a professional record of 31 victories without a loss, 21 by knockout. He is the former undisputed and undefeated light heavyweight champion of the world and the only king of that division ever to win the heavyweight title in the history of boxing. Because he never lost that title in the ring, he is still recognized by many, including Boxing Illustrated and Ring Magazine, as the heavyweight champion. Ladies and gentlemen, the undefeated man who brings the jinx, Michael Spinks. And fighting out of the red corner, wearing the solid black trunks and weighing 218 1/4 pounds, originally from the streets of Brooklyn, he passed through the hometown of the late great trainer of champions, Customato, Catskill, New York, and he now lives in North New Jersey. His professional record, 34 consecutive victories with 30 knockouts, including 26 KOs in 5 rounds or less, and 15 in the first round alone. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the undisputed, the undefeated heavyweight champion of the world, Mike Tyson.
Good evening, gentlemen. You were both given your instructions in the dressing room. Are there any questions by either of you? All right, both of you touch gloves. Good luck to both of you.
Could it be that this eerie atmosphere is what Butch Lewis wanted?
I don't think anybody is smart enough to figure how everybody would react to that. I do think that this fight will be decided by two things: how Michael Spinks can deal with the extreme pressure that Tyson puts on a fighter, that can totally discombobulate a man who's used to setting his own tempo.
Let's go.
What happens when Tyson hits him? Because he figures to get hit in this fight somewhere harder than he's ever been hit before.
I see that Michael Spinks is a little tight. His legs are not as loose as they normally have been in the past. Now watch Tyson jump right into his chest. Michael Spinks, give him a little movement. Keep those hands high. Very, very high.
Stepping in.
All right, stop punching. Whoa. Hey, Mike, knock it off, man. Knock it off.
Cappuccino already warning Mike about the elbows. Various opponents have complained that Tyson rocks them with elbows along the ropes in close.
You see the tactics used by Michael Spinks now. He's throwing his jab. but he has to keep those hands extremely high. Watch for the uppercuts, too.
Tyson landed a left hand in close quarters, and now Cappuccino goes to work again. Tyson not afraid, as we expected, and Spinks ready to mix it up with him. Tyson along the ropes doing damage.
Michael Spinks has to keep moving because every shot.
Uppercut landed inside, and Spinks went down. It was the left uppercut.
I was surprised there was a body shot that put him to the canvas.
And that is the first time Michael Spinks has ever been down in a professional fight.
And he's down again and in serious trouble. A right hand right on the chin.
Six, seven, eight.
He's not going to make it. It's all over. In that round was that Mike Spinks got hit, and his natural instinct as a champion and as a winner was to try to fight back instead of covering up, and because he wanted to fight back, he got knocked out.
There's a great deal of pandemonium in the ring now.
It lasted a minute and a half. There's a near riot taking place on the apron in front of us. Only now is it beginning to calm down.
The first time Michael Spinks has ever been knocked down throughout his career. We see Mike Tyson congratulate Michael Spinks, and Tyson trying to show some concern.
Please clear the ring. Clear the ring. Security, please clear the ring.
The pre-fight delay outlasted the fight by about 15 minutes.
I didn't expect Michael Spinks to go down from a body shot, but apparently the extra weight was a factor. I'd be interested to hear what Michael Spinks has to say. Michael Spinks started out pretty slow, and here we see Tyson, as usual, going to the body. A great uppercut that sent Michael Spinks to the canvas.
That was the second knockdown and the finishing blow. Watch again. This is after Spinks got up after one knockout, tried to fight back, and had nothing as Mike Tyson landed the right, the short right, to the jaw.
Here we have another angle, and that beautiful right uppercut caught him perfectly. It seemed to have caught him on the top of the forehead. And when his head went back and hit the canvas, it was all over.
Few fighters have ever thrown the uppercut with greater effect than this champion.
Another thing, Jim, is when a guy gets knocked out for the first time, you never know how he's going to react to that.
What you have just seen was the fourth shortest heavyweight championship bout in history. Only Jeffries over Finnegan, Michael Doakes over Mike Weaver, Burns over Roche back in 1908 were shorter than the 1-minute, 31-second destruction you just saw by Mike Tyson of Michael Spinks. In Mike Tyson's 35 bouts, he has now scored 16 first-round knockouts. And let's go now to Larry Merchant.
Mike, congratulations. Did you have any premonition that it would end this fast?
My trainer told me before I left, I bet both of our purses that you knock him out in the first round. So I thought he was serious, so just now he said he was lying. And so I went out and knocked him out in the first round.
It seemed to, what did you hurt him with? How did it start?
The first one was, I think it was a right hand on top of the head, but he took it well. And then I hit him with a short left hook.
Short, remember, short left hook? Uppercut.
It was a left uppercut that you told me to throw.
Right.
And then I threw a right hand to the body, and he went down.
And
then from that punch, I think what it was, the right hand off the head.
It was like a right hook over top.
It seemed to me that when he was hurt, his instinct as a champion, instead of covering up and running, was to fight back, and that's why you finished them.
From what I know of human nature, the only two things that he was capable of doing, either running or stinking it out, or come out and fighting. I knew either he'd be scared and come out fighting, and that's what I thought. Maybe he was a little jittery, so he came out fighting, giving it his best, hoping for a knockout or a cut or something, because he was fighting very furiously, as you noticed.
Mike didn't give him a chance to do anything else. After the first knockdown, he got right on and worked the body and came out after the head again. That's what knocked him out.
All right, what happened? What was all the delay about before? Do you think Michael just didn't want this to get here this quick?
Well, I think he was trying to scrutinize with my brain and make me wait it out. But, you know, I was getting upset. I wanted to go. I'm the kind of guy who just want to fight. Let's get in there and fight. I don't care who comes in first. We come in both at the same time. That's what we planned. I said, we come on together. And so my main objective was to go out there. Like I said, my trainer told me the whole purse is better on one round. Now I come back to collect my money, and he said he was joking. He didn't make the bet.
But it's still a good payday.
There was so much buildup that we can only wish that there was something more interesting or important to say from here at ringside in Atlantic City. The fact of the matter is, there isn't. Mike Tyson took care of that.
Eight punches and out. The walk to the ring, the introductions, the referee's instructions, the interviews, everything was longer than the fight. And Kevin Rooney, the trainer of Mike Tyson, is here with us, and I'm sure you weren't disappointed that everything was longer than the fight.
I love it like that, in and out. Let's get in and get out.
There was a long delay before the start of the fight. It seemed to take a little bit of the excitement and electricity out of the live audience waiting for the fight. What was the furor about? Were they simply applying a little gamesmanship, trying to upset Mike?
Basically, yeah, that's what it was. I mean, they made us think about the way the glove, I had tied the glove, and there was a little bit of a lump, and we wanted to tape it down. And the inspector, who's the boss, he approved it. Then Butch Lewis came back with Hazard, and he tried to make a big stink about it. And it was Lewis and the inspector, the big guy, they had words. I've read in the paper where they're trying to say Lewis called Mike a faggot. That's not true. He showed me and my fighter respect by not saying nothing, because if he started coming and started yelling at me, who knows what's going to happen, you know what I mean? But he didn't, and I respected that. His problem was with the inspector, but it was a bunch of malarkey. They were trying to upset the fighter, and it worked against him, because it upset him enough that he went out there and he did the job on his fighter.
It sounded, looking back, as though Butch Lewis was trying to buy time for a condemned man. Now, tell me about some of the psyching that went on before the fight. I didn't realize that Mike Tyson seemed to need all of it. Part of it was in meeting Roberto Duran. Then you told him that you had made a bet in which you were betting all of your purses on the knockout. And then you were wearing a cap that said, "This one is for Jimmy Jacobs," your late ex-manager.
Well, Mike doesn't need that psyching or whatever. These things just unfolded. Mike invited Roberto Duran to the fight because Don King wouldn't give Roberto Duran tickets to the fight. So when we found that out, when Mike heard that, Mike said, "Well, I'll give him tickets," because he loves Duran. Duran's a great fighter. So he came to visit with Mike, and that souped Mike up, which is good. I like that, because now there's another fighter that keeps him focused, which the whole idea of the camp and the fight is to be a professional and to focus on what you're going to do.
What about this little joke about betting all your money on the fight?
Mike has a dry sense of humor like me. Now, because I'm saying it now. He came out and he said, "I did say that." And he was walking into the other room. I said, "Oh, yeah, hey, Mike, you know, by the way, I bet my purse and your purse on a first-round knockout." But Mike knows that I don't got his purse. I don't have his end of it. Maybe he thought I bet my money. I don't know.
I've called what Mike Tyson does in the ring brute skill. And now we're going to try to show you some of the subtleties of boxing as seen through the eyes of Kevin Rooney.
Let's go. Let's get off the apron.
Kevin, take us through this live action of the fight and what you see. And I know this is the first time you've actually seen the fight.
That's right. Mike bringing it right to him. And we're letting them bombs go. That's sending a message. Right there. See, that was a good right hand that missed. He tried to sneak your right hand, Spinks. That one missed, obviously.
So that's part of the skill part of the brute force.
Sure, you can't hit Mike. You can hit him with a clean shot. And when they can't hit him, they become, you know, like confused and intimidated because they know they're missing. They, like, get confused subconsciously.
Were you surprised that Spinks didn't throw more jabs?
No. Mike got right on him. He made him fight. That was the plan. Right there. See that left uppercut? That's what hurt him. And then comes the body shot. Comes.
Come on, stop punching,
Mike. That was the only clinch. Was that Mike's fault, or did you give him a downgrade him for that?
No. I work on that. That's something I'm trying to work on, getting him out of the habit of doing that.
Now that body punch,
that hurt.
Must have hurt, and that was the start.
Yeah, there's a left up got his opponent. That's what hurt. That's what really brought him down. More than the right hand to the body.
Was he just going down for a rest there, did you think?
Yeah, he didn't even know where to go. The guy's all over me. He wanted to get out of the way.
Bang, that's where he took his shot.
Right there, but it was a good right hand. He's out. You know, I remember when he went down like that, because I was looking right up, I knew the fight was over. He's struggling up, and then the guy stopped counting, and I thought the count was a little long. But I remember the guy saying six, and then Frank said six.
You're not
seven.
Very happy there, are you? All right, now let's go through slow motion and show us where the skill is. For example, in the delivering of the punches, we've seen a lot of big guys. They don't punch as hard as Mike. Is it the way he delivers it?
Sure, it's the snap. He throws it with snap, with the correct form.
Which is what? Is it getting the shoulder in and
snapping? Well, it's getting the whole body and snapping the shoulder. That's really where it comes from.
All right, let's watch this and see. He throws right straight through it.
Right, he goes right through it. And the right hand of the body is a good snap.
Now you
see the shoulder? See the shoulder muscle snap? That one didn't miss.
All right, now you have obviously been working on him throwing more body punches because he's been remiss. He's leaped into clinches and he hasn't thrown the body punches. Is he there where you want him on that score yet?
No.
Oh.
You know, he's getting there, but he's not there. Because he doesn't throw that left hook to the body. I want to see that. That's a good left uppercut.
And he's rolling. It looks like he's rolling back and forth. Is that how he's trained?
Yeah, see, you can see the snap. You can see his shoulder snap. That was a pretty good shot. The one that missed was even better.
Okay, now the knockout punch. Describe that.
That was a tremendous right uppercut to the opposite side of his face. It shows his good power, but watching this tape, you know, Michael Spinks came off the rope after being knocked down the first time. He starts to throw the right hand. Mike makes the little head movement to make him miss, and Spinks shows how smart he is. He stopped throwing it because he knew he wasn't going to hit, but I think by doing that, and the fact that Mike is going to make a miss, he's off balance a little bit.
All right, so he moves away.
Mike lets it go hard.
And then he's hard. It seems that the commitment is so much a part of Mike Tyson. When he commits like that, he's leaving himself open, it seems. But he's making a full commitment to what he's doing.
Yes, but he's not open because we just saw it in slow motion. He made a miss that right hand. Spinks started to throw a hard right hand, and halfway through it, he wanted to stop it because he knew he wasn't going to hit him. And he was off balance, and then Mike had that tremendous snap and hit him on the right side of his face with his right hand, which is wild.
What makes Mike such a good finisher? Was it something that he got from Cuss?
Cuss always said, you know, professional fighter, when you got a man hurt, you take him out. You get him out, you get the fight over with. Anything could happen.
So there you have the anatomy of a knockout, and there is the anatomy of the man who was knocked out. After that, the issue no longer seems to be whether there's anyone out there who can compete with Mike Tyson now. But however prematurely, I find myself wondering, musing, whether there was ever anyone out there who could have beaten Mike Tyson. And here with me to go over that, a panel of experts, Mike Katz of the New York Daily News, Wally Matthews of Newsday, and Phil Berger of the New York Times. Given the scarcity of live opponents, have you fellas start to think of Tyson in terms of dead opponents?
Well, I would rather see in my mind Mike Tyson fight Lewis and Marciano and Ali than Razor Ruddock or Carl Williams or, heaven forbid, Trevor Burbick again. I think you're right. It's premature to imagine him as the best or the greatest yet. He's 22 years old, and he's never been in a fight.
Well, Mike, you have to go by what's out there, and right now he is the greatest, unless you want to try Hulk Hogan or Herschel Walker.
Well, greatest in history.
No.
Well, Phil, do you think he could have beaten Ali, Joe Louis?
Joe Louis, no. Ali, no. Not at this point. I'd have to see further development. And as far as what's out there now, Holyfield, Evander Holyfield, the cruiserweight champion, is the only one that could be a decent fighter.
I take from what we're talking about here that nobody takes seriously his announced retirement. He may believe it,
but that we all think we're going to see him fight again. Given that, he blames you guys for putting him where he is, for writing about his personal life, his battles with his manager. Did you guys do this to him?
Oh, mea culpa. I did it. Everybody, I want to confess, I convinced Robin to call NBC 10 days before the fight and blast Bill Caton. I also called Stephanie Givens, her sister, to call Wally. Wally didn't know this. And say, hey, Mike's been beating my sister. It was my fault, and I'm sorry, Mike. I'll never do it again.
Did she really do that? I mean, Wally, did she?
If it was written in Newsday, she did it. And I just want to say that I will take credit for bringing down the heavyweight champion of the world. If nobody else can do it, I'll do it.
What you have here is just a case of kill the messenger. Things are happening in his life that he doesn't have the control he wants, and the press is reporting it and following up on it, and this is bothering him.
Does the public out there care about this?
I don't think the public cares all that much about what Robin is after any more than they would care about any gossip about Madonna and Sean Penn. I think the fight public would rather read about who's he fighting and when, and this all I think plays in New York. I'm not sure it plays around the country.
I disagree. I think people are interested in the chaos, the kind of carnival atmosphere, the fact that the Tysons, Robin and Mike, were on the covers of so many magazines, I think is a clear sign of what the public interest is. Also, in Tyson, you have a very private creature, and when he does something, people can start to compute it into just who he is. People are curious. Who is Mike Tyson? What's he like?
As a fight fan and as a professional in the fight business, Wally, do you really care about that stuff?
Absolutely. First of all, I think you need to know these things to make an intelligent choice on who's going to win fights. Now, let's face it, all of us have outside influences that affect us.
Is that why you picked Spinks?
Thank you for reminding me of that, Mike. Yes, I think the fans do care. If not, why wouldn't the Dempsey-Estelle Taylor marriage be part of boxing lore? People obviously were interested in it back then, and they're interested in it right now.
Is it going to damage him personally?
I think professionally, I mean, I don't know what's going to happen between him and Robin over the years or over the months, but professionally, I think it may hurt in terms of endorsements. I think there may be a lot of commercial companies that won't want, you know, someone like Mike Tyson endorsing their products. I think...
Is he going to become a villain?
I don't think it'll get to that point, but I think people are starting to judge him more than they did earlier in his career.
Yeah, the plain fact is you've got a 22-year-old kid here who is a millionaire many times over, and all he's done lately is complain, and I don't think people are going to like that very much.
Mike, you've called Mike Tyson an ingrate. Why?
It's almost as if, since he's married, the women in his life, wife and mother-in-law, have asked Mike Tyson to forget about where he came from, forget about all the people who helped him, all the people who took him out of the ghetto, who gave him sparring partners when he was 14 years old, who took care of him, nurtured him, made him a contender, built him up, made him a millionaire by the age of 20, made him a champion by that age, and he's just supposed to forget these people.
Thank you very much, Mike Katz, Wally Matthews, and Phil Berger. For those of you who don't read the sports pages or even the front page, the infighting has been vicious on the surface, but below the surface, homicidal.
Below the waves of money and fame, tides of turmoil swirl in Atlantic City, starring Mike Tyson, the lovesick groom who was groomed to be a champ, Robin Givens, the beautiful bride who was groomed to be a star, Bill Caton, the old manager whom the bride and groom are trying to elbow aside, Don King, the promoter who feels he owns the heavyweight division, and Ruth Roper, the mother-in-law. You may remember the storybook career of Mike Tyson, the boy king of boxing, as it continued in Tokyo, where he polished off Tony Tubbs while the beaming Robin shared the excitement. But soon after they returned home, Tyson's ailing co-manager and surrogate father, Jim Jacobs, died. The honeymoon was over. Bill Caton, Jacobs' 69-year-old partner, the business whiz behind Team Tyson, was now sole manager. But the new Mrs. Tyson and her mother, Ruth Roper, began to accusingly demand the financial records and access to the champion's millions.
An incident happened and we noticed a discrepancy with Michael's money. If Michael has
$50 million and he's supposed to have $70 million. There's a problem.
Peyton, put on the defensive despite brilliantly enriching Tyson, lashed out at colorful Don King for trying to work out a separate promotional deal with the fighter, who said,
"Anyone else makes bigger issues than what they really are. You know what I mean? Don King's not my manager. Bill King's my manager. He'll always be my manager as long as I'm fighting. Don King's my promoter."
But the heavyweight champion attracted attention to his personal life, the marital problems of the perfect young couple. And they were amplified to a scream by a strange car accident and by King and Givens accusing Caton of trying to break up the marriage.
"I'll tell you clearly, I'm angry. I could tell you that a person very close to us, he offered him money, $50,000, to help us get a divorce. He said he'd stop at nothing less than our getting a divorce. This is like something out of Dynasty."
But that was followed by revelations made by Robin's sister that Tyson was hitting her. The newlyweds, however, continued to profess their love. Caton remained the villain or scapegoat. Then a full-scale confrontation broke out on the set of a commercial. As hundreds of workers waited hours, Caton was forced to agree to a slightly lesser percentage of his normal deal. Then, in Atlantic City, at ringside of the richest fight in history, which Caton had negotiated, Tyson, as he destroyed Spinks, also served legal papers on his manager. He charged him and his late co-manager Jacobs with fraud. Where in the months leading up to Atlantic City, Caton felt under siege from the bride, the mother-in-law, and the promoter, now he and Jacobs' widow Lorraine put the blame directly on the heavyweight champion, Mike Tyson.
"You tried to embarrass my family, you tried to disgrace us, and as far as I know, this might be my last fight."
Is it final? Stay tuned.
I found myself hoping through all the chaos that Mike Tyson could have diffused the tension the way Paul Hogan, Crocodile Dundee, did when he was squiring around his new love. He said, "I'm rich and famous, and she wants me for my money." Don King's main role in this seems to have been like Conrad Doebler's in that beer commercial, agitating both sides. Manager Bill Caton on the one side, Tyson, his wife and mother-in-law on the other, so that he can pick up the pieces. It's no mystery why he wants to pick up the pieces. Mike Tyson is on the verge of becoming the first nine-figure athlete. He could be worth more, much more, than $100 million someday. More than the most valuable baseball or football franchise. But there's a price to pay that can't be measured in dollars.
The battle over Mike Tyson's golden future is shredding connections to his storybook past, to the late Customato, his trainer, teacher, and legal guardian who rescued him from reform school, to the late Jimmy Jacobs, his co-manager and friend who helped finance his development and then steered him to the undisputed championship, to Steve Lott, the loyal aide he lived with for 2 years but fired at the insistence of his wife and mother-in-law, and possibly to trainer Kevin Rooney, whose closeness to Tyson and 10% deal is resented by his new family.
And the man who was borne the brunt of the attack, manager Bill Caton, is with us. Bill, Robin Givens and Don King have accused you of trying to bribe a priest, of breaking up their marriage with $50,000. Did you?
Of course not. I've been accused by Robin and Don of many things, but nothing as stupid as that. It is absolutely inconceivable that I would consider bribing a priest to break a marriage. The facts are just the opposite. I'm in favor of the marriage. Mike is madly in love with Robin. And the last thing in the world I'd want to see happen is that marriage broken up, because it would destroy Mike, and I want Mike to be happy.
She has also accused you of somehow tampering with the books, and Don King has even said very recently that you've never been willing to turn over the records.
Over a month ago, the complete readout on the manager's account was delivered to Michael Winston. That had every dollar of income and every dollar of expenditure from the time the account was opened, way, maybe at the very beginning of Mike's career. so that they know where every dollar has come in and where every dollar has been spent, and they haven't said one word about that.
So they haven't complained since getting that?
Not a word. No complaint, there can't be any. Everything is completely accounted for. Every dollar.
Thank you, Bill. We can expect many more chapters to that story. You might think a one-round KO is a short story, but the stories of one-round KOs, like Tyson and Spinks, are a lot longer than the fights themselves. They live in memory and sometimes in infamy.
The famous Lewis Schmeling rematch.
Well, I think the most dramatic one right now, that was Lewis Schmeling, which was, you know, the big grudge match with the honor of the Aryan race versus, you know, the black guy from Detroit. And that was the basic dramatic storyline one-round fight, probably in history.
The end came in 2 minutes and 4 seconds. Schmeling landed only one punch. I believe it was a left hook. Lewis did all of the fighting, and he was a smashing puncher. That was sensational. That was a sensational one-round knockout.
The infamous Marciano-Wolcott rematch.
Wolcott, in the first round of the second fight, hit Marciano with a pretty good shot, and nothing happened. And I'm sure in Jersey Joe's mind, there was subconscious, he figured, uh-oh, I've taken my best shot, that's it, let me get out of here.
He was very old at that time, and he was getting $250,000 guaranteed, more than Marciano, and he was maybe there just to go through the motions. But it is a fact, the eyes tell us that he was not hit very hard and took the count.
There was a lot of dissatisfaction. It was a fight for a payday.
The Liston-Patterson mismatch, in which Sonny Liston proved that the smaller they are, the harder they fall. He overpowered Patterson. Ali Liston 2.
The story I hear was that, hey, this time, Sonny, let's not take any chances. The kid almost quit the first time, so this time the first punch go down, and Sonny didn't wait for the first punch.
Leading to Tyson and Spinks.
Michael Spinks has to keep moving because every shot. Oh, uppercut landed inside and Spinks went down. It was the left uppercut.
I was surprised it was a body shot that put him to the canvas.
And that is the first time Michael Spinks has ever been down in a professional fight.
And he's down again and in serious trouble. A right hand right on the chin.
He's not going to make it. It's all over.
So you can write a novel about a one-round knockout. Back with us now is Kevin Rooney. Kevin, do you think years from now people will be looking at that minute and a half of tape and saying that was the essence of Mike Tyson?
I hope not. By saying that, you're saying he'll never fight again.
I don't mean that. I mean that that is one of the landmarks of his career.
Again, I hope not. I hope that there's someday still be a fighter that can really test Mike, really bring out everything he knows. He's, like, when I say he's only fighting 50%, I mean it, and I feel it's true. Because there's a lot of things that he's capable of doing and has done in the gym that he has never done in a fight.
Are you fearful then that his announcement of being retired, although most observers don't take it seriously, that it could seriously interfere with his career?
Well, the only way it could seriously interfere with his career is if he retires. Now, I take it, he hasn't told me that he retired. The last time I talked to him, he was going to fight again. But, you know, fighters and people in the fight game are crazy. Mike's a little crazy, I'm a little crazy. And he could definitely retire, he could. I think that he probably won't, or he shouldn't, because he's a dynamite fighter and he's not at his best. And I would love to see him break these records that I speak of, because I think he has a legitimate shot to do it.
You went into the ring wearing a shirt
with Customato on it, and you had a hat with Jimmy Jacobs, then you surely must be sick over this rift between the people who developed him and his new family.
Well, I don't understand it. I'm a guy, let's sit down and let's straighten the whole mess out. That's how I feel. I want Michael to sit down with Bill Caton and discuss it. I do know that Bill Caton is honorable and honest, and you can't ask for better. You can't ask for better for that.
From where I sit, you wonder why you would want to change something that has put Mike Tyson on track not only to be a great fighter, but to be probably the richest athlete in the history of the world by the time he's 24 or 25.
Well, I that's right. If something ain't broke, don't fix it.
Thank you, Kevin, for appearing with us. You're a stand-up guy. And finally this. For a man who insists he has peace only when he's at war in a ring, Mike Tyson manages to spend as little time there as he can. That minute and a half he warred with Michael Spinks, however, was as perfect a display of brute skill as we're likely to see soon, a pure diamond of hard knocks. The terrible personal unhappiness that accompanied his triumph is sad. Perhaps it has been caused by his being forced or by being willing to make a choice no one should have to make between his old family and his new one. For all its faults, boxing has never been that cruel. Compared to that, what Mike Tyson did to Michael Spinks was poetic and merciful. For Jim Lampley, Ray Leonard, and the HBO staff, I'm Larry Merchant. The executive producer of HBO Sports and the producer of Tyson Spinks is Ross Greenberg. This fight was directed by Mark Payton, and the feature producers were Michael J. Whalen and Steve Salvatore.
There's only one way to the top. You must feel that victory, release that energy, and ride like the wind. With fire in your eyes, shake those butterflies, and do the best that you can.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports, the network of champions.